church family, I'd like to welcome you to our Easter service. Now, I know that this service is unlike any Easter service that you've ever attended. And the whole world right now has been turned upside down. And we want to lift up and pray for each and every one that are struggling in any way. So I'd like for you to come and be a part of our church today. We are here, and we're here together as a church community. And so I'd like for you to maybe to get ready for today's service, to maybe set aside some time, any time today. Probably it would be best to do it at a time that you regularly worship. And bring your family, bring a Bible, get ready to sing with us, get ready to pray with us, maybe even bring some symbols. I've told my family and I've told folks to dress up like you normally do on Easter. Put those beautiful colors. And because you see, even though we're going through hardships and we're going through tough times, Easter is still here. Easter is still happening. And so we pray that what Jesus brought on that day, that new beginning, that new life, that new start begins today in our lives. Begins today in the lives of those that are listening to us, those that are visiting us from around the world. We've had visitors from around the world as well. And so we come to you as a church body. So let us come together and pray, lifting up concerns and prayers. So I'm going to ask you to lift up your concerns and prayers at the beginning of my prayer. And then I'll start praying some of the concerns that I've been hearing in the last few days. And then we'll get ready for the offering part. But for now, let us turn to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, there are so many things that we come to you today. Lord, for many of us, our hearts are broken. Our hearts are hurt. We are in distress. We are worried. We're anxious. And Father, we turn to you. We pray, Father, for a miracle. We pray that your healing touch start to bring a miracle so that this virus ends, Lord, that no more deaths, no more sick, no more hurt. We put it all in your hands, Father. Here at Kendall Church, we also lift up some specific prayers. Lord, we lift up Brian Runlett to you. Brian is a part of our church family, and he is in the hospital right now. Lord, and we don't know what he has. He doesn't have the virus, but we're worried he may get the virus. So we put Brian in your hands. Protect him, guard him, and bring him home as soon as possible, Lord. I pray for Susan Simpkins, who lost her dad this week, and her heart is broken because she can't be with him. Be with her family as they celebrate his life. So I pray for the Simpkins family. I pray for Brandon, Lord, who's a friend of mine who lost his sister in her 40s and young, Father God, and we just don't know what different people are going through. So we put those prayers in your hands, Lord. Lord, we also pray for that young girl that here in the South Miami community, South Florida community, just the other day got shot, Lord. And she was someone that many in our church knew. Some of her teachers go to our church. Some of her friends are associated with our church, part of our youth group, Lord. And so we just put her family, Andrea Camp is her name, Lord, and we put her into your hands, and her boyfriend, who's right now in the hospital as well. Father, we don't know why certain things happen, but we put it all to you, asking for a miracle this Easter, Lord, that you come into those lives and all the concerns that have been mentioned already in our hearts today, the heavy hearts that we have. We pray for our first responders, the men and women who put their lives at risk, Lord, so that we can be safe. Our police men and women, our firemen and women, protect them, guard them, Lord. Our nurses, our doctors who are working hour after hour and are tired, Lord, give them enough equipment to take care of themselves so they don't have to worry about getting infected or infecting their families, Lord. Father, we pray for all the victims that we've lost already. There have been too many around the world. We pray for those that are sick right now in the hospitals, that you heal them. We thank you for the ones that have already been healed, Lord. And we just right now, again, just turn to you. We reach out because we don't know where to turn. So on this Easter morning, when the miracle of the resurrection, when you brought in a new life, a new beginning, a new start, we pray for that in our country. We pray for that in our world. And that together, we pray to you the prayer that your Son taught us by saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who have committed trespasses against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen and amen. And again, we want to thank you for joining us this Easter morning. Wherever you are, wherever you're turning, you're watching us today, know that we are with you and you're part of our church family. One way you could help the church is by giving to us, and folks have mailed their offerings through, just go on our website, our address is there. You can also give online and just go on our website. There's a safe way to give online. And we want to thank you for those of you that have already been giving. We want to thank you for those of you that are going to give, and even those that maybe can't give to us, but give somewhere. There's a lot of need around the world, and there are people who are going to be in need. And so make sure that if God has blessed you with a job, if you are doing okay, that you reach out and help those that are hurting. Reach out to your neighbors, call them, be with them. Maybe you can't physically be with them, but let them know you're there. And now I want to thank our incredible music team who has come, and they are performing for us some Easter music so that you can connect. Our team of Paul and Tom and Jesse and our praise band, we are very blessed in this church. So we want to thank them and our choir director, Suzanne. Thank you, Lord, for those folks. And now our offering.
Floods in, we're risen.
What a time we're living in. And I pray again that you feel connected with the word that we have for you today. I want to welcome our friends, our neighbors from Killian Pines United Methodist Church who are joining us today. They're our neighbor sister church right around the corner. Their awesome pastor, Reverend Michelle Schrader, will be doing a Easter poem at the end of my message. But just, again, want to welcome our neighbors. And, you know, it's incredible that at this time that that separates us, right, that keeps us with distance from each other, it is a time that we can come together. And so our brothers and sisters from Killian Pine, we are one. So God bless you. All right, so everybody's making a fuss about missing Easter, right? And everybody is upset because the coronavirus is because of the coronavirus and because of the danger that we no longer are going to have Easter. But then I started to think, what's the big deal? And what I mean is, what is the big deal about not having Easter the way we're used to having Easter? Because what are we missing from Easter? Is it the Easter bunny, the Easter egg hunts, the hearing of Easter music while we're sitting in our pews at churches? Is it the Easter brunches? I like Easter brunches, right? Is it the seeing everyone in their beautiful, bright Easter colors? Is it the Easter message or the cool-looking crosses and bright colors everywhere, the flowers, the butterflies, the lilies? What are we really missing? Because, you see, don't get me wrong, I love all of that stuff. And Easter, we're going to celebrate that. In the United Methodist Church, the bishop has said that once we're able to come together again, that all United Methodists around the world are going to celebrate Easter when that day comes. So we're going to celebrate that. But what are we really missing? Because you see, none of that is really what Easter's about. Those things represent Easter to us, but that's not what Easter's about. So Easter is about the fact that it changed my life. And that Easter is still happening today. That Easter that we truly celebrate is still here. It's the Easter that has changed my life. The real Easter in my life happened the day that Jesus Christ was raised from the dead and brought new life and new transformation into the world and changed the world. The real Easter in my life happened that day in my life where I accepted Jesus as my personal Savior. And I accepted what he did for me on the cross. The real Easter in my life happened the day that Jesus became real to me, not just some fictitious character that was made up in my head or made up by my culture and made up it by a group of people that made it up. No, the real Easter happened the day that I read a book called The Jesus I Never Knew by Philip Yancey. You see, that book, and I've talked about it before, and I recommend it. It may not be anything for you, but it changed my life. Because in that book, I began to read the book, and I began to understand Jesus in a whole new way. And it changed me completely because I was able to see a real Jesus, not one that I had made up in my mind. And so some of the message today comes from that book, and I share that with you, and I hope you feel blessed for it. You see, because of the book, Jesus went from being a fairy tale figure to a real person that lived, and he changed my life. And that is the Jesus that I celebrate today. That one is still going on. I'm going to read to you a little bit about that Jesus from 1 Corinthians 15. 1 Corinthians 15, starting in verse 3. For I handed on to you as of first importance what in turn had I received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with Scripture, and that he was buried, and that he was raised, and on the third day in accordance with Scripture, and that he appeared to Caiaphas, and then to the 12, and then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to the apostles and to James, and last of all, to the one untimely born. He appeared also, says Paul, to me. It is that Jesus that appeared on Easter morning that changed Paul's life, that he went from being someone who killed Christians, who persecuted Christians, to being one that was eventually dies because of his faith. It's the Jesus that's alive that day that has changed my life and changed millions of people around the world. That Easter is what we celebrate. All right, so let's look at this Jesus. I want to point out a couple things about this Jesus that might be different to some of you. Some of you may not know this about him. And here are a few observations. First of all, and you cannot forget that Jesus was a sinless friend of sinners. He was a sinless friend of sinners. Now, I know it's hard to take in. How can he be sinless? And even why is that even important? Well, it's important because there's a major reason why that had to be. You see, the Bible tells us that each and every one of us sin, and that because of the sin, we cannot truly have a connection with God. God is perfect, and something that's not perfect, get this, something that's not perfect cannot get close to God. So God created a way, right, for the imperfect, which is me and you, a way for the imperfect to be able to approach the perfect, which is God. And that was by sending a part of himself, sending a part of the God self to live a perfect life, and then eventually be an example on how to live. And then he actually died for my sins. And why did he do that? So that the imperfect, which is me and you, can then reach the perfect, which is God. So the imperfect can now be with the perfect. All right, so that is what Jesus did for the sinner. But the other thing that we need to remember is Jesus is a friend of sinners. If you look at the Gospels, just look at the Gospels and you'll see time after time. You know, and unfortunately for a long time, the church has acted like in some way we are the perfect ones and that we are the judges of who can come close to Jesus. Right? And that sometimes we have taken the Bible and only emphasized the parts of the Bible that we like, and then we don't emphasize the entire Bible, just the parts we like, and then we pick and choose who is in and who is out. Now, there's a problem here. Throughout the years, that line of who's in and who's out has been moved, and it's so hard to tell what it is, the truth. And so some folks have said, well, Pastor Reuben, that's easy. You just read the Bible. But the Bible is not as clear as we'd like it to be on this issue, right? The Bible's not as clear. I know some of you are sitting there going, yes, it is. But you know what? It is not as clear on who's in and who's out. But it is clear on one thing, and that is in Jesus Christ. And so I choose to follow Jesus. I choose to follow the truth, the way, the truth, and the light, which is Jesus. And in Jesus is what changes lives. It's who, through him, I am in, right? And he came for everybody. So we turn to Jesus and we follow him as an example. Now, one thing you cannot deny also is that that Jesus is a friend of sinners. In some ways, we can argue that he even preferred sinners over the religious people. And why is that? Probably because sinners knew they needed him. The religious people often act like we don't need him. You know, one of the biggest challenges throughout the Christian history, right, throughout the history of our church, is how we balance between legalism and grace. And this has been going on for a while. It happens in every church and every denomination. How much are we legalistic and how much do we show grace? But look at Jesus. Jesus had a way of balancing graciousness towards the sinner, yet at the same time, he had hostility towards the sin. You know, unfortunately, much of the church history, we've done the opposite. What do we love? We love power. We love greed. We love money. We love prestige. We love vice, of course, under the table. And we're hostile towards the sinner, which are the ones that need Jesus the most. You know, Jesus was and is all about grace. Now, that doesn't mean that Jesus said, hey, do whatever you want, act in any way you want. No. But he said, you can be better. I accept you as you are, but you can be better. And that's the challenge of the church. Look at who Jesus spent time with. The Samaritan woman. As a matter of fact, she was probably the first person that he actually told that he was the Messiah. And she was a sinner. And she had a messed up life, and she did all kinds of things that were wrong. But yet he loved on her by being with her, and he said to her, now go and sin no more. He often would celebrate a groveling tax collector over a God-fearing Pharisee. I love about Zacchaeus, who is another tax collector, who did things awful to the people. Yet Jesus said, hey, Zacchaeus, I'm coming to your house, which means he honored him. right? He said, I'm coming to your house to be with you and to spend some time with you. He honored him. And then he said, now go and sin no more. Look who he hung out with. Even on his dying breath, one of the last words he says on the cross to a thief who, as far as we know, was never religious. And he says, today, because of your faith, today you'll be with me in paradise. Who did Jesus hang out with? Those 12 disciples were a mess. But I love those guys because they remind me that this mess can also be part of God's world. So the challenge for the church is that we need to follow Jesus and not the religion. We need to keep a balance of love and of challenge. While at the same time, we need to accept people, even if they're committing what we think are sins. Can we figure out a way how to just love? And we love them so much, like Jesus does, right? We love people so much that they begin to change and become who God created them to be. All right, another thing about Jesus in the Bible that you know, that you need to understand. Not only was he a friend of sinners, but he was also God. He was God-man. And I know that's a hard concept to understand. I know it is. Now, think about it this way. In many ways, it would have been easier if God would simply have said, look, this is a set of rules, and I want you to follow these rules. These are the rules you need to follow. Great, right? We would all know, okay, just if I follow these rules and follow them completely, then I'm fine. God is covering me. But no, you know what God did? He said, no, this is part of who I am in Jesus. Follow him. Follow his ways. The rules will make sense to you if you follow him. Our religions, or even other religions, believe that Jesus was a good moral teacher. And that's all he was. A lot of the different faiths believe he was a good teacher. Non-believers have admired his teachings. Someone like Gandhi, and I've already said this, Gandhi said, listen, I like Jesus. I just don't like his followers. Right? But see, the problem is that we cannot separate Jesus' teachings, Jesus' morality, right? The way that Jesus lived. We cannot separate that from the claims that he made. Because he was very specific, right? He said who he was. And who was he? He says things like, if you have seen me, you've seen the Father. No one, he says, no one comes to the Father except through me. To a lame man and an adulterous woman, he says, I forgive your sins. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He said, before Abraham was born, I am. He actually used the sacred Hebrew word for God, which is I am, which is Yahweh, several times. It offended the religious people so much, they wanted to kill him. And I want you to understand that. It offended them so much, they wanted to kill him. Jesus' claims of who he is separates him from any other major religious leader throughout the history. Philip Yancey, who wrote The Jesus I Never Knew, says this. I now see that Jesus' entire life stands or falls on his claim to be God. I cannot trust his promised forgiveness unless he has the authority to back such an offer up. I cannot trust his words about the other side. Like he says, I go and prepare a place for you. Unless I believe what he has said about having come from the Father and return to the Father. Most importantly, unless he was in some way God, I must view the cross as an act of divine cruelty rather than sacrificial love. The cross is where God showed his love. I want you to think about if you've ever been around a parent or if you're a parent. You know, and as a parent, when your child is suffering, you know, I've been around parents and I can't tell you the number of times when a child is suffering, the parent will say to me, if I can only change places with my baby. If I can only change places with them, I would. I mean, that's incredible love. Well, God did that. And he did that through Jesus. Jesus changed place with me and with you. Because you and I sin, we fall short of the glory of God. We're selfish and we're greedy and we hurt people and we do things that don't deserve God's love. So God said, listen, I'm going to go myself and pay the price. I'm going to put myself in the place of my child so that you can have eternity. And he had to do that as a man. All right, another thing about Jesus is that he's also the portrait of God. Right? When you see Jesus, you see God. From a former chaplain of Harvard, a guy named George Budrick, tells a story about a young man one time came to his office and said, listen, I don't believe in God. And the chaplain said, well, tell me why, tell me about this God you don't believe in. And when the student started to describe the God that he didn't believe in, the chaplain said, well, guess what? I don't believe in that God either. And he started to tell him about Jesus. In some theological circles, God is often depicted as cold, distant. You can't even mention his name. You need to fear God. You need to follow God's direction. Or in those cultures, in those settings, God will kill you. In some places, God is supreme, so supreme and omnipotent that he's not even approachable. God is depicted as a legalistic, unloving disciplinarian. Actually, I know some Christian churches that depict God that way. But Jesus changed everything. Jesus made God approachable. Jesus actually modeled to us the kind of relationship we should have with God. He actually called him Abba, which in some understandings is like saying daddy. Jesus dies on the cross so that we can come and have that relationship with our Father. And if you read the Gospels, there's one line in Matthew. And I think it appears in another Gospel, but the main thing is that it's a line that actually explains to us what Jesus did in a very subtle way that if you don't know, you may miss it. I find it in Matthew 27:51. And the Bible says this, at that moment, which is right when Jesus died, when he took his last breath, the Bible says, at that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, the rocks split. You see, the curtain that scripture is talking about separated what the Hebrews called the most holy place, where God dwelled, and it separated God from the people. But now, because of what Jesus Christ did, no longer is that curtain there. Because of his sacrifice, God is approachable. You know, if I was going to invent a God, right, I would never make him like Jesus. If we're honest, actually, if you think about it, if we're going to, these are traits that we don't even want our presidents to have. Someone who's honest, humble, forgiving, comes from a poor family, from a poor town and a poor nation, meek and peaceful and loving, with no real worldly accolades or accomplishments, not willing to use his power to show off, eventually dies before he has ever won any wars or any battles. But Jesus is who I want God to be. Jesus is who I want my God to be. Loving and humble, forgiving, regular, peaceful, accepting, miracle worker. Jesus gives us a clear picture of who God is. The next thing Jesus does is he's also a portrait of humanity. Because he's not only God, but he's human. And get this, Jesus is who humanity should be. He is the reflection of what God had in mind when he created us. Remember, we were all created in God's image, and Jesus reveals what that image should look like, the way he lived his life. Get this, philosopher Blaise Pascal said this: in the incarnation, which is Jesus coming and becoming, which is the Son becoming a human, right? The incarnation shows man the greatness of his misery by the greatness of the remedy which it required. Jesus Christ exposes our failures as human beings by his example. He shows us where we miss the mark. You know, I sometimes hear people, well, you know what? I'm not perfect. I'm only human. But God, you know, gives us, says, no, Jesus was only human, but he did it, and you and I can do it too. Jesus shows us what we can be and how we can live and how we can love and how we should treat others. Jesus became one of us to save us. Also, he's the wounded healer. You know, you can learn a lot about our religion by looking at its sacred symbols. Just look at the world's religions and look at some of the symbols. And what's interesting, what's odd, it's just odd, it makes no sense, is that Christianity's sacred symbol, the most known symbol in our faith, is the cross. How odd that an instrument of evil, an instrument of torture, an instrument of death would be the symbol that we pick. Kind of like an electric chair, right? Why not emphasize other things about Christianity? Why not have a symbol of the Easter as our main symbol, or a symbol of his miracles? Slightly mention his death, but really emphasize those. But no, our most sacred symbol is the cross. Why? Because the cross reminds us of something. First of all, that sin is real and it's painful and it's dirty and it's ugly. But it also reminds us that there's hope. Because of the resurrection, that there's hope. It reminds us that through Jesus' wounds and brokenness, you and I were healed. I often say on Sunday mornings that, you know, when we do communion, that we are reminded that Jesus had to be broken so that you and I can be healed. And then finally, and I love this, this is why I'm a Christian. Jesus is love. Many of you hear my struggles on a weekly basis, how I struggle with the fact that I used to say, I cannot, there are people in my life that I just can't love, right? Because I just don't like them. But you see, there's a difference between love and like. You don't have to like everybody. You just have to love them. When I realized that, it changed my life. It changed my faith. It changed what I have to do. There are people that I just don't like, but I love them. It means I respect them. I treat them with kindness. I do and make sure they're taken care of, but I don't have to hang out with them all the time. Well, Jesus emphasized love over and over. Now, if you think about it, the whole concept of a loving God is crazy. It makes no sense. Why would we have a God that wants love? No other religion emphasizes love. But Christianity does. You know, the Quran in the Muslim faith almost never mentions the word love when you associate it to God. In Buddhism and Hinduism, they do not emphasize a loving God. That's not part of their theology. Now, if you grew up Christian, you may miss it, but that's who we are. For God so loved the world that he sent his only son, and that whoever believes in him will not perish. The prodigal son story of a son who failed his father, ran away from his father, did all the wrong things, and yet the father accepted him with broken arms, with open arms, and said, here, I accept you. That's love, and that's God. 1 John 4 says, this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sin. Greater love has no man than to give his life for his friends. Romans 5:8, while we were still sinners, meaning while we were still messed up, while we were still denying God, while we were still lying and cheating and doing all the things we do, God still loves us and sent us his very best. But you know, one of the things that I know about people, that every single human being has in common, is that every single one of us just wants to be loved. We just want to be accepted. Doesn't matter our religious background, our race, our culture, our sex, how much money we have, how poor we are, how sick, how healthy. Every single person just wants to be accepted for who they are and to be loved. Can we, the church, this Easter, This Easter that has been unlike any Easter that has ever happened. Can we, the church, begin to actually love people? Even people that we may think are sinning. Can we just love people and let God change their hearts? As he did with me. Can we really be the church? You know, Easter is a big deal to me. Because it reminds me who God is. And a pandemic cannot take that away. After we experience the real Easter, you are transformed. Easter matters because it is about what happened in the past when Jesus died on the cross. Easter matters because this is what's happening in my life right now, which is he's constantly transforming me. And Easter matters because of what's about to happen someday when we will all come together again in his glory. Will you celebrate that Easter with me? Lord, we just come to you today, a broken people. Of people that are not even able to come and hug and be together because of this virus. Of people that are scared about our future because we don't know what's going to happen. Of people that are scared of not even knowing if we're going to have enough food in our tables. Or if we're going to die because we're out in the street. We worry for our children, for our parents. We worry, Lord, that life will never be the same again. And that everything we know and everything we're comfortable with has changed. But you are the same. And you haven't changed. And the promise that you bring on Easter, a promise of transformation and a new beginning, is here today. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Blessed and redeemed. and happy Easter. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. This is Michelle Schrader. I'm the pastor at Killian Pines United Methodist Church here in Miami, and I also serve the Southeast District of the Florida Conference as the Missions Initiative Specialist. And so I send greetings this morning to my community at Killian Pines watching, and also to the folks at Kendall United Methodist Church, and thank you for letting us join you in worship this morning. I have a poem that I wrote several years ago that I wanted to lift up for you all, hoping that you might find it meaningful this morning. It's called "The Immovable Stone Rolled Away." I heard the story traveling early in the morning. An immovable stone had been rolled away. Death tried to ensnare him, but life got away. I wondered what this would mean for someone like me. I spent little time with him, living my life mostly concerned about me. This news seemed to have a life of its own. It's as if there was a door inside of me opening to the unknown. I wanted to see, to experience the gift of it all, but I was not sure this wonderful news was meant for a person like me, so small. So I crept to the garden and waited to see, and I found him there kneeling on one bended knee. There was light all around him, yet I did not fear, for something about him made me want to draw near. He held out his hand and he looked in my eyes and he pierced me with knowing that took me by surprise. The light of his presence seemed an invitation, but I couldn't believe someone so great would want to be with someone like me. The fear and doubt were deep inside, but truth in human form was kneeling right beside me. He stood as if he was going to leave, but he turned and said the words, "Come, follow me." The way he marked out was filled with sacrifices of love and obedience and trust in this truth from above. The gift of the story is not one to keep. The truth of it lives inside of me like a deer attempting to leap. The immovable stone did indeed roll away. He lives. He lives for the big and he lives for the small. He lives so that life in its fullest form can come to us all. The immovable stone did indeed roll away. And I stand before you to share that immovable stones, they still roll today. This is an Easter poem offering for you, and I hope you find it meaningful. And just know that I'm praying for all of you this Easter morning, hoping that the love and light of God surround each of you on this day. I give thanks for the risen Lord and for the hope that that brings to each of us. Remember, we are a human family in this journey together in the midst of the coronavirus. And I'm so encouraged by the ways I'm seeing people come together across many divides to maintain this understanding of human family, children of God all around the world. So until we meet again in person, know that my love surrounds you all and my prayers are with you. Deep peace. Amen. Thank you.